But do you think that you were open enough to experiments? Did you think you experimented enough?
I think we experimented a little too early in terms of time. I think we experimented, honestly, without enough money to back that experimentation. Because what we learned is that definition of fun, definition of fit, definition of what innerwear should do is something that is not just Indian, but global, that has been from the time the corset was set out. And therefore, to fight 100, 200 years plus of a mindset has to mean really, really deep pockets. Because we set out to say that if there is innerwear that is meant to perform a certain function, it doesn't have to look a certain way and it doesn't need someone else's opinion. I think case in point is every time we interacted with our consumers at our pop-up stores or when they came for trials, etc., we would shout out from this side, does it fit? Do you need another size? Even the most conservative of them would come back and say, do you mind coming in and taking a look and tell me how it looks? So it came down to, and how does it look on me? And therefore, does it fit me? Versus we ask you, how does it fit you? How do you feel in
the experimentation that we did was in one direction, right? Very early on. We experimented a lot with the outward aesthetic on one end, perhaps very little on the form. If we had experimented to a wider, saying that, okay, this is a form that will appeal to a wider mass and this is a form that will appeal to, perhaps we would have come up with this idea that has succeeded earlier. Right. Mm-hmm. To me, that sort of brings me to the time you take for that experimentation and then the money you put behind that, mm-hmm. and the money you leave on the table to actually execute your experiment. You know, you can do as much experimentation as you want and spend as much time. We are taught that you have to fail fast and fail early. Right. But after you failed and you've succeeded and you finally found out of like 100 ideas that one is working, do you have enough money sort of to be able to then take that and run with it to the market? Or do you then need to sort of realign your goals in terms of scale and speed? And I think that was something that was interesting, because the speed with which we wanted to take off, mm-hmm. was much, much faster. We hit the ground running, like Ivy said. We had to really realign ourselves to the fact that, and sort of failed enough and found something that worked. We have to realign ourselves to a far more organic, slower pace. I remember sort of meeting this mother and her two teen stroke early 20s. So there was a 19-year-old daughter who was still in college and, you know, a 22-year-old who just started working. And, you know, they saw the product and said, we want to try. So these are bralettes, right? They're soft, unstructured bras, not your typical underwired, structured, conventional bras. And they tried it on one by one and came out. And I remember very distinctively them walking out of the bathroom to show it to us. And, you know, excitement in their eyes saying, wow, this looks so cool. And it just feels so comfortable. And the mom immediately, you know, this bit of consternation on the face said, nahi beta, it's making you sag. And I would observe literally the next couple of minutes of, you know, power between mother and daughter, where the mother is saying that it's not making you look as good. And the daughter is fighting, saying, it looks fine. There's nothing wrong with it. And I love the look. They're young adults, right? So they have the gumption to be able to stand up, and they've developed an opinion. And each one of us develops confidence at various ages. Invariably, it is sort of closer to high school and college. And also, at a particular age, we never question what the adult tells.
Yes.
We take it as a fact.
Yes. Yeah. So that really sort of brought home a point, you know, as a mother and what I'm saying and how I'm reacting to just people and situations around me. But more importantly, you know, this is the way we are impacting the world as parents, you know. And in this one decision, you are too embarrassed to speak to anybody else about it except your mother. And you're even too embarrassed most of the time to speak to your mother. It takes you some time to find a voice.
And if you're soaking in that look is more important than how you feel, then that becomes the hygiene for you to start filtering decisions of not just what you're wearing.
These are the insidious ways in which messaging gets across to our younger generation.
I think in our case, for example, challenges was we had I loved the Excel sheet that I put up in terms of projections, etc. As we obviously didn't hit those very nice looking numbers, year one, year two, the reality is this, that a lot of times, especially when we set out to build brands and things, the assumption of who our consumer is, there is a tendency, I think, for founders who love their ideas to assume that they represent the whole buying population, right? If I look back, you know, whatever it may be, I think the socio-cultural mindset, assumptions around that are very critical. Whether you put yourself in your shoes or actually take a step back and look at data the way they are, right? Or the story that the data is actually stating, that is very important. There's a tendency to love the product for itself versus the fact that it's actually selling. So as an entrepreneur, I think the real joy of once you've got the product right, and when I say product right, it's features, it's pricing for that as well. The question is therefore, how do you scale it from there and explode it